Cochran's got a show tonight. He's in the know tonight. He's on the go tonight. When he's rubbing you the wrong way, then you know that he's right. BJ Rubin's got a show. BJ Rubin's got a show. BJ Rubin's got a show tonight.
Ladies and gentlemen, thanks for tuning in to watch the BJ Rubin Show. Tonight, my special guest is Joe Franklin. Joe, how are you doing tonight?
I never felt better. I'm looking forward to, as I mentioned privately, BJ, you've been my role model since I'm a little kid, and to be here with you is very exciting to me, and I've told all my friends I'm going on with BJ Rubin. They say, BJ Rubin? And I say yes, and they're very happy for me because I finally got my big break right here today.
Joe, you flatter me. I'm glad that I was able to do this for you, though. I mean, I've worked a long time to be able to give you this platform.
I wouldn't sell our friendship for $100. I really mean it.
You're a legend, Joe.
In my own room, in my own mind, right?
In your own mind, that's right. So I was hoping you could maybe tell me about how you got started in show business.
I was just choosing the records for a young man who had a very popular radio show once called Martin Bluck. I'm sure you probably might have heard about the Make Believe Ballroom. Maybe somebody told you about it. And I got a phone call one day from Channel 7. They were only on the air then from 5 o'clock until sermon night. There was no daytime TV. They said, Joe, we're considering lighting up to do some daytime program here on Channel 7. And we like your voice. And if we give you an hour a day, Joe, what kind of a show might you do? I said, what if I do a show? People talking nose to nose, eyeball to eyeball. I said, Joe, you're out of your mind. You can't do a talk show. The word is television. You got to give them vision. You got to give them sales bottles, pratfalls, baggy pants, burlesque skits. You got to give them funny stuff. So I said, well, so then rock and roll was just coming. I said, how about I do a show of kids dancing to records? They said, Joe, now we know you know. So who's going to watch kids dance to records? Who comes along? Dick Clark becomes a billionaire. But I defied them, BJ. I did the world first pure organic from the bones TV talk show. My first guest ever was Eddie Cantor, Sophie Tucker, Kim Novak. And I had 28 episodes of the Joe Franklin Show, and I had half a million guests. Half a million. I had Ronald Reagan 5 times. I had Richard Nixon twice. I had, Frank Sinatra twice. Bing Crosby twice. I had Charlie Chaplin. I had Cary Grant.
So tell me about Charlie Chaplin. I think he's great. What was it like interviewing
Chaplin
him?
Told me, believe it or not, that people spend hours and hours and hours analyzing his books under a microscope. They're examining every implication, every Freudian shading, and they write big books about all the hidden meanings. Every time, I mean, put it simplistically, every time he kicks the fat man in the behind, he's supposed to be knocking the establishment. He swore to me that he had nothing in mind except to make people laugh. They're analyzing what was never there. He got such a kick. There may be 100 books analyzing Charlie Chaplin's movies, and there's not one truism because he had nothing in mind. He just have to make people laugh. That's Chaplin. He was the greatest. In the old days, they wouldn't say, let's go to the movies. They would say, let's go see Charlie Chaplin. Chaplin was the movies. You know what I'm saying?
So tell me, what were some of your favorite interviews?
I would say Bing Crosby. I always thought of Bing somehow, BJ, as being what you might call mechanically reproduced. I thought of Bing on radio, on records, on movies, on TV. But when he walked toward me that day, flesh and blood, I think that day I melted. I think I did my best interview ever with Bing. I just idolized. And the funny thing about Bing, if I can insert this from left field, he was not that romantic. It's kind of ironic that the most romantic balladeer of all time was not romantic. He would tell his songwriters, don't put the word I love you twice in one song. He'd rather be out hunting or fishing with the boys. But whatever it was, he had a great, he still got the biggest selling record of all time, White Christmas. And you can't deny that. And the day of my show, he went in the street, walked up to a girl in the street, he says, my name is Crosby, want to go on a gig with me? Then he got into the subway. I got the photograph of the show. He got into the subway, went to Aqueduct to bet on the races. He was a regular common. He was a great, great man, Bing Crosby. I loved him.
So you said that you had 500,000 guests on your show over the years.
One I didn't get, I wanted to, was Greta Garbo. Have you heard of Greta Garbo? The famous actress, Greta Garbo.
I've heard of Greta Garbo,
She wouldn't come.
Turned you down?
Well, she turned down everybody. They offered her a blank check signed if she do another movie or another TV show. She could insert her own amount, her own payment. She said, no, I've made enough faces. I think you saw a movie once that she was in called Two-Faced Woman. She said, I saw this movie. I made enough faces. I quit. Like Marilyn Monroe, like Greta Garbo, they're frozen in time. We think of them the way they used to be, not if they got old and wrinkled. Like me, you know, but I mean, saying, we think of a young and 36 years old and glamorous, and that's a little test of time, I guess.
So Greta was the one that got away.
She's the one who got away, right. I wanted her, but I mean, I knew her socially. We'd go to films, retrospectives or movies together. We had dinner. We went to a restaurant called the Nutrition Center, where she liked health foods, but wouldn't come on any TV show, mine or anybody else's.
She never did a single television show.
No, not one to the best of my knowledge, ever.
Wow. I've never heard of an actor doing that. I feel like actors these days, they love to go on talk
shows. Well, I once asked Robert Mitchum on my show, I said, Robert, which of your movies that you made do you like the best? You know what he said? He said, Joe, I get paid to make movies. I don't get paid to watch them. That was a pretty snappy answer from Robert Mitchum, I thought.
My question is, how did you choose the guests for your show?
That's also a great question, BJ. I can see why you're on the way. I had what they call an eclectic mix. I never had a talent coordinator. Did my own booking on my own telephones. I would feel in my mind who'd go well. And I had, you talk about eclectic, I would have Ronald Reagan on with the dancing dentist. I would have Margaret Mead with the man who whistles through his nose. They liked it. So I had the Ramones, the Jay Giles band. I had everybody that ever lived. There's nobody I missed except Greta Garbo. So I've got out of 28,000 shows, I saved maybe 500 shows on video. So I was very careless about preserving my own. There is a big box set out called Joe Franklin, King of Nostalgia, which sells pretty well. And I've written 23 books. My last book, called Up Late with Joe Franklin, sold 75,000 copies. And they're all in my house. No, it's a big seller.
Only 23 books, Joe?
23. The book was blurred. Because the first two printings were the third printing was blurred. I killed that one. But I'm enjoying my reminiscing here. Listen to the reminiscing with Joe Franklin and BJ.
Do you have any advice for someone who'd be looking to get into showbiz these days?
I would say don't bump into furniture. Don't leave your wallet in the dressing room. Well, I would say be persistent, be consistent. The rejection rate is horrendous, but don't let it upset you. And if you stick with it, you'll make it. Every year, if you make it in the big, big time, you know. And it's a rewarding profession. It's a fun profession. If you can't tell the world she's a good little girl, or just say nothing at all. That's an old-time song title.
That's exactly right. So you're a fan of the telephone, you'd say, Joe.
Of the what?
Of the telephone.
Oh, I got two phones. Sometimes I got to have them surgically removed from my ear. I get maybe 200 calls, 300 calls per day.
So what are all these people calling you about?
Well, they want to come on my radio show. I'm on Bloomberg Radio, you know, all day long with my interviews. It's called The Business of Show Business. And I was always able to feel in my mind that the chemistry, who'd go well together. So I've got that knack. This week I've got Paul Anka, I got Neil Sedaka, I got Lindsay Wagner, I got Barbara Eden, I got Cyndi Lauper, I got Shirley Jones, I got June Lockhart. I get pretty good guests, but it's...
It's not a bad list.
I'm not going to quit till I get it right. Let's put it that way.
So how will you know when you've gotten it right?
I'll call you, BJ. I respect your opinions. I honor and respect your opinions.
You're going to let me be the judge of that?
I guarantee it.
That's very nice of you. So, Joe, while you're here, I mean, is there anything you'd like to know about me, BJ Rubin?
Well, have you ever been impersonated on Saturday Night Live the way Billy Crystal did me for 4 years? Not yet, huh?
You know, honestly, that's never happened to me.
You know what I said the first time I saw Billy Crystal doing Joe Franklin? You know what I said? Billy, one of us is lousy. People always ask me my little rule for success in my the calamity the catastrophe the mortality rate in my business is 500 talk show shows hosts came and went during my tenure. 500 came and went. I say the reason for longevity in my field is sincerity, and once you've learned to fake that, then you got it made. I'm so honored. I'm having a good time with you, BJ. I turned down so many things, but I've seen your show and I like your personality, I like your style, I like your speaking voice, and I'm going to be plugging this on the radio. I'm going to get a big rating when this thing is being seen. BJ, I want to make a deal. You come on my show one day, and I've enjoyed this so much. You're a good interview. You're a great interview. You asked me some really good questions.
Thanks, Joe. I appreciate it.
I mean, I'm very sincere about that. You know what would happen on my tombstone? Somebody asked me, what would happen on my tombstone? You know, I'm going to say, I'll be back after a short break. No, I got a better one. How about my agent told me I'd be playing better rooms than this? That's even better, right?
That's a good one.
I apologize.
What are you apologizing for, Joe?
I'm only kidding.
You're watching the BJ Rubin Show.
Up next, Rat Fist. Up next, Rat Fist. Up next, Rat Fist.
Not good with the ground. I'll get something down. No Matata.
Why would I ever want to kill another person?
Mr. BJ Rubin owes me a Rubin sandwich for working for free for 50 years.
Todd, why did I bring you back here, Howdy Doody? You caused nothing but trouble.
Shut your fucking face, kid.
You can't talk to me like that.
Shut your fucking face.
This is my show, not your show.
You're right about that!
Yeah, I am right. I invited you. That was nice of me. Now you're making a jerk of yourself.
You were a kind soul! Until you taught me to be bad!
Wow!
For 50 years I had a secret! Shove a nickel in my ass for more of the story! Do you like my lips on your cheek?
You're kidding me, Howdy. I think that was inappropriate.
You hear me, you son of a bitch?
Howdy Doody, you gotta lay off the drugs, man. What came over you? You used to be so
nothing.
Nice.
I'm feeling fresh today. How are you? Ah! This song is called Baby's Little Breasties. I want. And a two, and a one, two, three, four. Baby little breasties touch my feet. Baby little breasties stomp on me.
No Matata, BJ.
Drunk and I'm proud. I'm getting loud, I can't deny it. Familiar late night sounds have the neighbors all testified. Might as well speak out at least one time before I die. The crowd's allowed to tear it all down and get drunk and get proud. I've been fucking things up lately, I don't give a damn. I'll be coming to your house, let you know just who I am. Nothing goes as planned, everything will fall apart without a doubt. Might as well have another round and get drunk and get proud. Well, I'm drunk and I'm proud. Try to carry me home if you think you can. Within a half an hour, you'll be wishing I was some other man. It's an awesome power, it's a drink of bourbon in my right hand. The bartender keeps pouring it out. I get drunk and get proud. Better suited to the rougher crowd when I'm drunk and I'm proud. Pretty much it.
But I can't recall it like it was yesterday. There were perfect red lip marks on your neck. You smiled, then laughed, and now it's always raining. My tears fall. And yes, it's all.
Matata, baby!
So, Harris, you wrote a book.
Yes.
Could you show the people your book that you wrote?
Sure.
So this is a book that you've written and published yourself, correct?
Correct. It's my money, and I want it.
What's your secret, then, Harris?
Ah, the secret. The secret is using your money more efficiently.
I wonder about what got you into this. When you were a kid, did your parents sort of motivate you? Did they inspire you to the importance and significance of money? Is that part of your tutoring?
Absolutely. Really? Absolutely. When I was
so should parents teach this to their kids when they're very young?
Oh, that's where it starts. As
really?
A parent, you're the model. You are providing what they are going to be. In fact, as I laugh at parents sometimes, they don't like some of the things that their kids do. And I say to them, well, you know something? It's a good chance that whatever you see in them that you don't like, it's a good shot they got it from you. So if you want to see a change in them, you need to change yourself first. Now, I was 20 years old, getting married. I was going to go into business. And I said to my dad, how much money do I need to be rich? I want to be rich. So first thing he said was, what would you do if you became rich? He says, quit working, lay on a beach all day. You'll get bored. Eat two extra slices of pizza, wear two extra pair of pants at a time. He says, that's nonsense. Whatever you're looking for, you're going to find in the middle of the day, in the middle of your life. So, okay, I understood what he's talking about, you know, happiness, you know, but I wanted to be rich. I said, Dad, please, how much money do I need to be rich? Answer me. He said, tell you what. If you always spend a dollar less than you earn, you'll always be rich.
So, Harris, my question for you is, how can I buy your book and find out all your secrets? Learn more how to live like a rich man.
The website is harrishelps.org.
Any recall, BJ, how money as a young man played a role in your life or the influence of money in your childhood or anything you learned from your parents about this subject matter? Does the matter chatting here interest you today?
Well, I got my first job at the age of 10. I got a paper route where I delivered papers in my neighborhood, and I would use the money to go buy comic books. So, I mean, from a young age, it instilled in me the desire to earn my own money so I could do with it whatever I liked.
Can I tell our friends what some of those comic books are worth today?
Not a whole lot.
I had a friend of mine named Bob Kane who drew Batman, and when he got divorced, his wife was so incensed for revenge, she went into the closet and cut 15 copies of Action Comics number one in half, and they're worth today $1.5 million in pristine condition.
That's correct.
So don't cut up your old comic books if they got Superman or Batman on the cover.
Not just yet. Joe, where can people tune into your radio show?
Well, it's on Bloomberg Radio, 11:30 a.m. on the dial, on the Killer Cycle dial, 11:30 a.m. It's pretty loud today. They say we talk to 35 million people every day in all parts of the world. If the wind is strong, it even goes to Brooklyn. No, I'm only kidding. It's heard all over the world. And I've got a one-minute thing that rotates all day and all night where I do a little segment called Listen to the Reminiscing. And I want to tell you one more time that one of my favorite all-time classic shows was with the Jay Giles. Remember the Jay Giles Band?
I do remember the Jay Giles Band. That centerfold song was theirs.
Two platinum records at one time. One was called Freeze Frame. One was called Centerfold. And they were offered they were in town for one day only, the Jay Giles Band. They were offered $75,000 by David Letterman to do his show, but they came on my show for nothing because they said, Joe, we like you on the road. We watch you every night. We think you're warm and sincere and honest and so forth. So I was very close with the Ramones. Remember the Ramones?
I do remember the Ramones.
They were very close with me. I had them on many times. So just I'm trying to make it of the moment very current, very officially what's happening now, and to be here with you, BJ, and talk about the bands and the rock and roll and what's happening now is a big kick for me because I'm very much into the present and the future as well as the past. It's been my pleasure to be with you, BJ. Once again, BJ, I'm a real fan, past, and I'm sure very much into the future as well.
That's great. Thanks so much, guys.
No matata, BJ.